Hello and welcome to James Bond Radio, episode number 51. My name's Tom Sears and I'm joined by my good buddy, Mr. Chris Wright. Say hello, Chris.
Hello, Chris.
Now, it's a bit of a red letter moment for us at James Bond Radio today, isn't it, Chris? Are you going to tell the people why?
Well, I'm rather excited. I almost feel like a giddy schoolboy.
Yeah, very nice.
And the reason for that is we have some special interviews today, don't we? But not just one, we have two.
We have a double barrel interview. And not only is it just an interview, you know, usually we have, you know, authors and people like that on, which is great. But this time we have two absolutely real live to the flesh Bond girls on the show, Chris. How do you feel about that?
Well, you know, it can't get much better than that. Not even one Bond girl, but two. I mean, that's double the fun, isn't it?
Doubling
really?
Up indeed. So we have Martine Beswick, who you would know as Zora from Rush with Love, and as Paula Caplan in Thunderball, obviously. She's a double whammy Bond girl. And we have Caroline Munro, who everyone will know as Naomi from The Spy Who Loved Me. How cool is that?
So cool, so cool. The amount of time we've watched them in film and gone, oh,
yeah, there we
don't
go.
They look good.
So they'll be joining us later in today's episode for a good old chat about their time on Bond. So before we do that, how have you been this week, Chris? You been doing all right, mate?
I've been a bit poorly, actually. You'll probably notice it in my voice. Oh, get the violins out.
You've been kissing girls again, Chris.
Ha ha ha, very funny. No, just been a bit down, but I'm on the mend. That's good. That's the important thing, isn't
good
it?
Good stuff. Excellent work. So we've got lots to talk about today, haven't we, really? There's been an influx of kind of Bond news. Spectre news is coming in. We've got, you know, Bond book news, and it's kind of, we're reaching that point now where we're getting close to the release of Spectre, and all sorts of stuff is coming out, and it's kind of getting to fever pitch point or close to that fact, isn't it?
Without a doubt. We're getting little nuggets pretty much every day, aren't we? There's always something that links to something. Some of it's just made up bullshit, but that's okay.
Absolutely.
But you know, it's all a part of the big sort of, you know,
the big
publicity,
the big
thing.
Circus of Bond.
Yeah, exactly.
So before we get stuck into that, make sure you come and join us on Facebook. Just put James Bond Radio into the search. We've got a lovely community going on over there with stuff being posted every single day. So come and join us on there. Make sure you come and follow us on Twitter, which is at James Bond Radio. Same goes on there. Everybody's posting about Bond stuff and great discussions to be had on there. That's all good. And then you can come over to jamesbondradio.com and join the discussion in the comments section. And you can also leave us a voicemail on there as well. There's a big old button. You can leave us a voicemail through the computer, whether that's a listener quote or some trivia, or just want to say hi and ask questions for one of the mailbag episodes or whatever it is. You can do that. It's always good to hear from you. And last but not least, if you wouldn't mind coming to our iTunes page and leaving us a lovely glowing 5-star review, because that really helps us to rank higher on iTunes and attract more listeners, which is always very nice. Yeah. Got to grow that old family. Okay, so let's get cracking with today's show.
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond.
James.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British hand up, sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy. As you can see, I have no problem with females already.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to buy.
Okay then, Chris, so I suppose the big news of the week, well, there's been two items of big news, I suppose, but the kind of the big news of this week is the announcement of the Spectre theme song singer, which is, who is it, Chris?
Nelly Furtado.
Nelly Furtado, good God. That's going back a little bit, isn't it?
It is a bit. Now, obviously, Sam Smith, which his name was banded about back in the day, wasn't he?
He was like the first one, wasn't he? It was kind of always him from in terms of the press. It was always that was the main rumor back when the film was first announced. And he revealed in his interviews actually that it was done and dusted back in January, so it's been in the bag for a long time. And there was the kind of we actually got a little scoop. We had one of our people everywhere send us a little little scoop. Which was that they were going to announce who it was on the 8th. So we managed to report that last week. The only Bond website on the internet who did so, I'd just like to add. Lovely. Finger on the pulse. And yeah, so we knew it was coming. Apparently what it was a load of the cinemas in the US were emailed to say on the because obviously the advanced screening tickets went on sale on the 7th for us in the UK, but in America it was going to be a day later. So they were emailing all the cinemas to say, put your tickets on sale on the 8th because it's going to tally up with this announcement. So that's how we found out. So so mystery secret spy, I salute you. Thank you for the information. Obviously, yes, he needs to remain nameless because that's what you do when you're a 00. You've got to be a little bit sneaky.
Unless you're James Bond, then everyone,
knows who you are. Absolutely.
If you're Roger Moore, that is.
Yeah, completely. So there we have it. We've got Sam Smith with singing a song called "Writings on the Wall." So that's an interesting little nugget. So what are your feelings, Chris? What do you think?
Well, first of all, I guess you got to look at the other names that are banned about. There is Ellie Goulding, there is Radiohead, I guess there are one or two others, potentially another Adele. Now, for me, I've heard lots of responses from people who have been either like super negative about one singer or another. But I look at it like, until you hear the song, how can you harshly critique it?
Yeah.
And in all honesty, I only know a couple. I've only listened to a couple of songs that Sam Smith has done before. I know he has got a good voice for sure, but I'm not gonna go, oh no, it's gonna be crap now, because it could be a banger. It might be like a really, really good song, and until we hear it, I think we just got to wait and find out.
Yeah, I think it must be said, from sort of cruising the social medias, it seems like the overall reaction has been negative towards Sam Smith. Most people seem to be saying, oh no, drony old git, I don't want to listen to that, or whatever. Which is, you know, it's fair enough if you don't like that person's normal musical output. But then at the end of the day, when you think back to the kind of, you know, previous, all through the Bond songs, if I was to say, I probably wouldn't consider myself a fan of most of the Bond title theme singers in their normal career, but whatever they bring to the table when it comes to Bond is like a nugget of gold. I can honestly say I don't really listen to Shirley Bassey all that often, but her Bond songs are absolutely banging. So I think that's all that matters, is whether he dishes up a good song or not. And I feel it's the same. For me, it was like, oh, I was kind of thinking if it had been Radiohead, which was the big rumor, I was primed for that, because I'm thinking, oh, that would be quite interesting. That's kind of out of left field. That's going to be a different take of it. In all truth, I'm not really a fan of Radiohead. A bit too whiny for my cup of tea, even though that's sacrilege to a lot of people to say that. But I was all primed for that. So ultimately, it all boils down to what he dishes up. And the story goes that he wrote it within 20 minutes and they loved it immediately. And the actual vocal they used on the final version is the very same vocal he recorded in his original demo back when he originally wrote it. So that's quite an interesting thing. And sometimes that's the way it goes. It's whatever they capture with that first idea when they're writing a song is just, there's just some magical thing about it that they can't reproduce. So it's going to be interesting.
Here's an interesting point then. Do you think he was approached by Eon they were the only person that they had in mind, and they approached him and said, right, we want you to do the song, see what you can come up with. Yeah. Do you think he thought, oh, there's a Bond film coming up, I'd love to be a part of that, I've got an idea, and then did it and then passed it on? How do you think the process was?
I think it's perhaps been different for different films, in the sense that, like, some of them, like for example Tomorrow Never Dies, they seem to cast out a huge net, loads of different bands and artists and stuff submitting songs and all that kind of stuff, and then other times it seems like there was one person in mind straight away. So I don't know whether they do it slightly differently every time, or whether it's just, you know, whoever seems to be about. But a lot of people are saying that Sam Smith is the safe choice, in the sense that he's almost like this year's male version of Adele, isn't he? He's like, you know, he won the Grammy Award or whatever, and he's like the man of the moment, so to speak. So yeah, I kind of had a listen to his you know, some of his stuff after the announcement. It all seems, you know, I would say in the same, I would imagine he would appeal to Adele fans, do you know what I mean? It's all, they're very sort of piano-y ballads and stuff like that. But yeah, I'm kind of intrigued.
From the same mold, aren't they?
Yeah, it's cut from the same cloth, I would say. But I'm intrigued to see what he comes out with. I've totally reserving judgment. He's not somebody I would listen to normally. We'll see. We'll just see how it goes, I guess.
Two too right. So what do you think of the title? Now, I still haven't seen that trailer.
Yeah.
But I know that the title relates to something in that trailer, which I read.
Yeah.
So that, I mean, without sort of giving away too much, do you think that works? Is that good? Are you happy about that?
It definitely, again, I will stay cryptic because we haven't given a spoiler warning, so we won't reveal any spoilers for anyone who hasn't watched the trailer. But there is definitely a link between the title of the song to something that happens in the trailer, so that's a good sign. So that implies that perhaps he was given a copy of the script to read before he even wrote the song. Not sure about that, but whether that's true or not, but... So it doesn't sound like a particularly Bondy title. It's not like you got the title of the movie in it or anything like that. Writing's on the wall. It's a bit of a sort of an ambiguous title, like an all-time high might be, or and all that kind of stuff. So again, I've got to just completely reserve judgment until we hear this song. Hopefully it will be a complete banger when it comes out, and it'll be a classic.
There is a nice little link though to one of your favorite Bond films, which I'm sure you've got.
Yeah.
From the title,
yeah, the old Q scene when Q's demonstrating the exploding pen, and Q says, "Don't say it," and Bond says, "The writing's on the wall," and then we have it. So there is a little link back to GoldenEye as well. I don't know whether Sam Smith had that in mind when he wrote it. I would say probably not, but you know, it's a nice little touch.
You never know, along with the rest of it.
Yeah.
So that's good. And I did like the album cover as well. What do you think of the album cover? It's kind of like. It's like the circle, isn't it? The gun barrel, almost silhouette with him just standing there. It's, you know, it's kind of classy. It's kind of Bondy, and so it's not bad.
Yeah, really. Sort of does the job. It's nice. Yeah. So cool. So Sam Smith finally revealed. There it is. So the release date of that is going to be on the 25th of September. I was assuming that we would hear the song the same day, but obviously not. Yeah. So, but thinking about it, I guess it makes sense because. You've got, if you actually reveal the song on a different day, then you've got two news days. You've got two press events, haven't you? You've got the revealing of the artists themselves, and then next week or whatever, they can be like, oh, here's the actual song, and then it's another day in the public eye, isn't it? So I guess that makes sense.
Okay, so here's a question for you. Are you going to, if you heard that it was, like, it'd been leaked somewhere, would you, before the release date, would you go and listen to it? Are you going to try and listen to this song as soon as you can?
I'd be all over that. Yeah, definitely. I remember when Skyfall came out, I remember there was a leaked version that came out with... Do you remember there was a story about they used her tribute singer to record the demo because she had some vocal damage or something at the time and couldn't sing?
Yeah.
I remember a demo came out with a different voice who sounded very much like Adele singing on it. And it was just a few, like, it was not the complete song. It was like maybe a minute of it. And it was a little bit faster. The instrumentation was a little bit different. And I remember hearing that before the final one. So I'd be all over that. For me, the song isn't like a spoiler thing. I'm not bothered about not hearing the song beforehand. That for me is like, that's something to get excited about before seeing the actual film. Yeah.
It's strange because with Skyfall, that was another thing that I avoided, and I managed to do it right up until about 5 minutes before I actually saw the film when we're at that charity premiere.
Yeah.
And then the band just played Skyfall tune as we were about to walk in, and I was very much. But this time I'm not too bothered. I think I will listen to the song. I'm not too bothered about holding out for it. I think I'll obviously with the trailer. With all the sort of footage, I'll definitely try and avoid it. But the song, I think, might be all right.
Yeah, that was a brave move, man, and to get all that way through up to actually walking in to watch the film before you heard it. That was a good. But it's a shame, isn't it? Because you heard the version by some dodgy tribute band somewhere instead of the actual one.
They weren't Cue the Music, in case you're wondering.
Yes, they weren't Cue the Music. There was somebody else. One of Cue the Music's inferior copycat bands. So I'm excited, man, as soon as that comes out. So that's the 25th of September, so a couple of weeks away before they actually release. Hopefully we actually hear the song before the song gets released before then. That'll be nice, but I'm intrigued, man. I hope it's a good one.
Me too. So in other big news, I heard you were in Waterstones the other day.
Well, yes, Tuesday was obviously the release of Trigger Mortis, the new Bond book. Here it is. I've got my copy there. Lovely stuff.
Ooh, that's a nice cover.
I was in there 9 a.m. sharp. They hadn't even had time to put the display out. I was the first one through the door, got my copy, came out. It's good. So the Waterstones version The difference is a black cover. It's the same cover, but it's black instead of like a grey, which is the kind of standard cover. And then there's a sticker on the front which says includes unseen Ian Fleming material exclusive to Waterstones. And what you have at the back, which I haven't read yet, is you have the original typed manuscript of Murder on Wheels, which none of the other editions have, which is pretty cool. So at the moment, I have read the prologue and the first chapter. I'm taking it easy. I'm taking it nice and steady. Yeah. And I must say, I'm intrigued. And there was a part of me that thought, because there's a lot talking about Goldfinger in the first chapter. Again, I won't reveal any spoilers. Not that I know many at this point. There's a lot talking about the sort of intricate details of Goldfinger. And part of me was like, man, should I perhaps stop and reread Goldfinger first before I read this? And that's kind of why I haven't gone any further actually at this point, because I'm still in two minds of whether I should do that or not. But I tell you, the prologue sets things up very well. It's like the pre-title sequence for the book, I suppose. And that just that it doesn't even have Bond in it, but it made me smile. It was like, oh yeah, that's setting the scene for what's about to come. I was excited by it.
So it'd be interesting to see, because again, it wouldn't be a spoiler, but if you think reading Goldfinger before would be useful, that'd be quite an interesting thing to know. Because obviously to get on that, which is good. So, you've only read a chapter, but does Anthony Horowitz, you know, is his style similar to Fleming or any of the other writers, or is it too early to call it?
I feel like within the first chapter, I feel like there's some things he said, which is just like internal dialogue that Bond is thinking, the way Bond is feeling in that particular time. And I feel like he has got that nail, he's pinned it on the donkey and he's hammered it home. Like he's absolutely bang on with that. Like, you know, sometimes you read some things and it's like, whether you read fan fiction or whatever it is, and you're like, oh, Bond wouldn't really do that, or Bond wouldn't think that, or he wouldn't say that. He's no worries with this. Like, as far as I've gone in the first chapter, it's just like the way Bond is thinking, his internal dialogue just feels right, totally. In terms of his writing style, you know how we said, like, William Boyd, it almost felt like reading a Fleming, or reading Kingsley Amis almost felt like reading a Fleming book. I feel like his actual writing style isn't like that. But it's still in Fleming's world. It's definitely Fleming's Bond, so far at least. But in terms of the writing style, I think he's not like aping Fleming's sort of style of writing. He's kind of doing his Anthony Horowitz voice, but in the world of Bond. So far, that might change as I go through. But as I say, I'm only a couple of bits into the book.
Well, I've just ordered mine today, so I look forward to when that arrives.
Very nice.
But it's a bit of a strange thing. I know we've mentioned it before with other things, but the fact that sort of the US and Canada get different sort of dust covers, different front covers to the UK ones, to European ones. And on the whole, a lot of them prefer the European ones. And it does seem a strange thing, because it seems to happen quite a lot on DVD covers and book covers and everything
like that. Yeah, I don't know what it is. The American cover just... It's more of like a sort of painted cover, isn't it? It's like an old school painting almost. Mm-hmm. Whereas with this, it's almost like the schematic, the blueprint of a rocket or whatever. Yeah, technical. I think that cover is brilliant and I really like it. The American cover, not so much. And I've noticed that with a lot of the Bond covers, the American covers seem to just be a little bit rough looking compared to the British ones. But I don't know why they would bother to redesign the cover. I don't know.
No.
But hey ho. So the other kind of reveal we've had in recent times is the what we believe to be the final Spectre poster, which is obviously Bond in his white dinner jacket with his carnation on, silenced wolf of PPK, with the kind of Baron Samedi image background with the skull face and the top hat. Again, I must say, there's been some mixed reviews of it. Some people are saying, yes, I love the simplicity of it. It's great. Others saying it looks just like somebody slapped two images together and just stuck it up there and not put that much thought into it. So what are your thoughts on the poster, Chris?
It's interesting. Well, straight away, like Live and Let Die and Goldfinger shouting out through and through. It's interesting. I think the poster is good, but I can easily see why some people would want more. Personally, I think they should have a double... like a double poster sort of scheme running alongside one another. One is a simple with just the characters, because there was another one, wasn't there, with Bond and Madeline Swan, yeah, same background. One like that, and then another one that shows a bit more, that is a bit, you know, a bit more artistry to it, a bit.
See, what a lot of people are saying is that there's, like, if, for example, if you look at the old school posters, or even posters like even GoldenEye and Tomorrow Never Dies, you had those sort of big sort of scapes where you'd see, you know, the big face of Bond in the middle, surrounded by his Bond girls, and then maybe some scenes of action in the foreground. Like, for example, the Living Daylights poster as well. You had the gun barrel, if you remember, with all the action going on. And people were saying they wanted to see that kind of poster again. But when you look at Daniel's Bondian period, he's very much of the sort of men's aftershave kind of advert, or the menswear kind of look, isn't he? Do you know what I mean? It's usually him with just an undone collar, just standing there pouting, looking cool, and not much else. They're all very minimalist, aren't they?
So
I guess that's just the kind of look they're going for. It is very, very minimalist, isn't it? And I know a lot of people were underwhelmed. It is an odd one. I think, especially with the image they've chosen for the background, which is taken from the trailer. Yeah. It's just a still from the trailer, which is that background image. So yeah, I don't know. It is an odd one. Yeah.
It also made me, I don't think this will happen because I don't think he's in that segment of the film, but the fact that you've got, you know, it's an outfit sort of thing. Mm. And the hat he's wearing is a bit odd job-esque hat. And I know that the character of Mr. Hinks is kind of like an odd job brought up to date, obviously not the hat, but I think that's what they were going for. So I was thinking, is he in the scene wearing one of the skeleton outfits, like Jaws wears a clown outfit in Moonraker?
Well, Chris, I as a trailer watcher, I know about that, and I can't possibly reveal it to you. So I can't say a word. For anybody who's not watched the trailer, same thing. For anybody who has watched the trailer, thumbs up. We know what's going on. But there we go. So yeah, no comment on that one, Chris. No comment.
Okay.
Yeah, watch the bloody trailer.
Yeah. All right. Sorry. But yeah, I think overall, you know, it's not bad. Personally, I would have liked to have seen, if they kept with that, which is fine, I think something else as well, maybe just to run alongside it, perhaps. But I guess, like you said, it's kind of like that is the Daniel era type sort of thing that we're going for, isn't it?
So there's some more interesting discussion to be had about that. Obviously, Daniel's been in the news lately saying that, you know, well, he hasn't said this, but that a lot of the news outlets are reporting that this could be Daniel's final Bond. Now, when you look at what he actually said in this interview, they said, oh, you know, so you're going to do another one? And he's like, oh, I couldn't even conceive of doing another one at this point, meaning I'm so knackered from doing Spectre, I don't even want to think about it yet. That's essentially what he's saying. Obviously, the press have taken that, being like, oh, Daniel might not do another one. Bullshit. Of course he's going to come back and do another one, without doubt. Yeah. Now, nothing says that to me more than the fact that if you look at that poster, Daniel actually has a co-producer credit, which is the first time this has ever happened for a Bond actor. So this is a really interesting talking point, because if you think about the past, that's what Connery wanted all back in the day. And, you know, Cubby and Harry wouldn't hear of it. And, you know, there was all sorts of bad blood and all that kind of stuff. Whereas this time around, it feels like they brought Daniel right into the fold, co-producer credit. That's a big deal. What do you think about that?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think, well, it means that he has more of a say over a wider area. So it's not just his character. He'll probably have a bit, you know, like in Quantum, he sort of had a bit of an influence with the script, and I think he probably does on all of his Bond films.
Yeah.
I think that credit is a nod to his increased input about every aspect of the film. I really think he's the sort of person that would have something to say about any aspect of the film. Plus the fact that it's also an additional incentive for him to have that credit, and I'm sure there's an additional financial incentive behind that as well. But that's not a bad thing.
No, you know, I think that's the thing, isn't it? Usually, from what we know about this kind of stuff, is that, you know, they pay them not a great deal for their first Bond movie, and then their wage sort of amount goes up considerably from movie to movie, especially if they're successful. So it's kind of like, you know, it must be, we know how much Barbara loves Daniel. Do you know what I mean? She's very complimentary about him. And I feel like for the first time in the whole series, the Bond actor has really been taken seriously and let to have some input into what happens as well. So I guess this is just one of those things where Daniel's, you know, this is his fourth Bond movie coming out soon, and he's definitely going to be thinking about moving on sooner or later. And this is the way to keep him on board for even longer. You know, let's give you a co-producer on this one. So he's definitely going to come back for number five. And then, you know, I'm sure, do you know what my gut feeling is? He's going to come back for two more after Spectre and do a nice round number. So we've got four from Spectre. I reckon he's going to do six Bond movies total. That's what I think.
Well, I agree with you definitely initially that he's 100% doing one more after Spectre, 100%. Yeah. It's just a newspaper. The thing is, as soon as the newspapers sort of grab that, then you're like, oh yeah, David Beckham wants to be Bond. Hugh Jackman wants to be Bond. You know, and you hear it everywhere and it's like, you know, that's just stupid. So I think 100% he'll do one more. I think there's a big chance that he'll do two more as well.
Do you know what I think will end up happening? I think Spectre is going to be, it's going to beat Skyfall. I'm just going to put it out there. It's going to beat Skyfall in the box office. I think it's going to be so successful that they're just not going to let Daniel go. And what's going to happen? It will be like with Roger, in the sense that they, you know, I think it was Moonraker was going to be his last one that he was contracted for, if I remember rightly, somewhere around that point. And then he was on a film by film basis all the way to the end. And I think, knowing how what great lengths they went to get Mendes back for this one, they don't want to lose Daniel. And I think they will squeeze every last film out of him they possibly can before he finally does move on. I think we've got him for longer than longer than we perhaps think.
And I definitely agree with you. Spectre will out box office Skyfall as well. Without a doubt, I think it will.
Definitely. Sure. Cool stuff. Yeah. So what else? The other interesting point, I suppose, is that in the running time for Spectre, it's listed as, how long is it? 100 and...
Some of them have said 150, some 160, but a lot of that is to give the cinemas an idea rather than an exact figure. So we still don't know the exact runtime. What we do know is that in terms of the other Bond films, we had Honor Majesty's was 142 minutes. So for a long time, that was the longest Bond film. Skyfall was 143 minutes. So that obviously was a bit more. But prior to that, Casino Royale was 144 minutes. Sometimes think places list it as 145. But basically, Casino Royale is the longest Bond film. Skyfall just behind that and Majesty's just behind that. So there is a chance that Spectre could be the next sort of longest Bond film. I think we can safely say that even if it's not, it's definitely going to be around that sort of runtime. So we're not going to see, you know, 104 minutes like Quantum of Solace was. It's definitely going to be like sort of the other Danny Boy films that we've seen in the past.
Absolutely.
So I don't think that's a bad thing at all, is it?
No, I think it's like, for example, when I went to see The Wolf of Wall Street, that was a very long film, very long film. But it was structured and paced so well that it didn't feel that long. It was like, it was just bang, bang, bang all the way through. But I think it was like a 3-hour movie, wasn't it, that one?
It was,
And I loved every second of it. So I think as long as it's paced like that, then you can't go far wrong.
Well, what are your two favourite Bond films at the moment?
My two favourite Bond films at the moment, Honor Majesty's Secret Service and Casino Royale.
Well, there you go. And they're both two of the longest.
There you go. So good sign then. The longer, the better. Yeah. That's what we say. So speaking of Spectre and the release date, 26th of October, 2015, obviously. Those of our listeners on Facebook and Twitter will know that we're having a big JBR family meetup viewing on that day. So there's an excuse to come and sign up on the social medias. So far we have around 30 people that are signed up to come with us. Basically, we're going to the 11:30 showing at night on October 26th at the London Leicester Square Odeon. So that's the cinema where they used to have all the premieres. So there's some serious Bond history going on there. So if you want to come and watch it with us, you are more than welcome. If you head on to our Facebook page, you'll see the event page on our Facebook page and you'll see all the details. We've even put down the two seats we're going to be sitting in so you can kind of sit with us in the group and all that kind of stuff. We're going to have a big old meetup and meet everybody and meet up for drinks beforehand, certainly meeting up for drinks afterwards to discuss the movie and all that kind of stuff. So it's going to be a huge event, big JBR family get together. It's going to be good. I'm excited.
And also, we were thinking of going to Royal Albert Hall and, you know, getting drinking in the atmosphere and seeing what happens there. So if anyone's free, you know, to join us then. And anyone who, that's not going to this, that screening, if you're going to another cinema or the previous screening at 7:30, come and join us before, come and join us afterwards.
Absolutely.
And we'll have a good little chat and get together and talk about Bond.
Absolutely. So if you're not on the social medias, come and join us on Facebook. If you haven't got a Facebook account, stop messing about. Get yourself a Facebook account. Come and sign up to the event, and then we'll get a rough idea in numbers, and we'll have just a bloody good night. So so come and do that. Come and get involved. October 26th. Get your tickets. Odeon Leicester Square, 26th of October, 11:30 p.m. showing. We're seated in the Royal Circle, aren't we, Chris?
Oh, yes, rather.
Well, very nice. Okay, good stuff. So before we crack on with today's interview, it's time for some Bond trivia, isn't it, Chris?
Well, I was just going to mention, actually, there is one other thing we're thinking of.
Oh.
There was a few weeks ago now, Madame Tussauds mentioned about a James Bond waxworks, which they're doing an exhibition of all the Bonds. And I know quite a few people were interested in seeing that. So I thought, if for instance, some people can't make the premiere or aren't going to be sort of in London at that time, it might be a good thing to arrange a JBR get together, you know, go to Madame Tussauds, check out the Bonds, and again, have like a bite to eat and a drink afterwards.
Sounds bloody good.
No official date yet. We'll find out when it's all set up. But, I mean, that's something else we could
do. We're all about the JBR meetups. Absolutely. It's time, isn't it? It's like with football fans, the World Cup rolls around. Everyone goes apeshit for football for a bit. It's the same with Bond whenever a new movie comes out. So let's maximise it. JBR meetups all around. In actual fact, there's another JBR meetup in New York. Obviously not with you and I, Chris, but one of our listeners in New York City has put together a group viewing for JBR listeners over on the Facebook page as well. So if you live in New York, go and check that out on Facebook and go and join that randy group of listeners, rowdy group of listeners. Maybe they will be randy after the film's over. I don't know. And you can have a JBR family viewing over there as well. And I think there was one in Sydney, Australia as well,
yeah,
wasn't it?
That's right. There's one in Sydney as well, yeah. So there's going to in every city that's out there.
Let's
get one in Rio. Let's get one in Tokyo. You know?
In all the different stations around the world, absolutely.
Yeah.
There we go. JBR listeners unite the world over for Spectre. So let's do some Bond trivia then, Chris. What have you got for me this week?
Well, I think I went quite easy on you last time. So I have got a bit of a toughie for you this time. Now, it's not a one-word answer, so it'll be interesting to see how you get on. But I think it's also quite an informative thing, so we'll see. So my question of the day, so Tom Sears, is how many different gambling games do we see in the Bond series and in what films do they occur?
That is a very difficult question.
It is.
Huh. Okay. Actually, you know what? When I think about it, a lot of them are coming to mind. So that's not too bad.
I think you'll get a lot of them.
All right. Okay. So my question of the day, Mr. Christopher Wright, is
yes.
An easy one. My question is, in what Bond films do we see Bond himself using a throwing knife? That is, in which Bond films do we see Bond himself using a throwing knife?
That's a really good one as well, good one.
Good stuff. So, it's that time, Chris. It's time to interview our first Bond girls. How do you feel? Oh, I'm excited.
I'm really excited.
There's nothing like a Bond girl to make us boys go weak at the knees, is there?
Hell yeah. Too right, yeah. We'll try. The thing is, when we interview them, we'll just have to make sure we don't dribble too much, otherwise it might scare them off.
Control ourselves, try and remain as composed as we possibly can. Yeah. So, like we said at the beginning, we have Caroline Munro, who you would know as Naomi from The Spy Who Loved Me, the helicopter pilot Naomi. Very good
does
at
a really sexy wink.
Absolutely, she does indeed. She's good at the old winking. and obviously we have Martine Beswick as well, which everybody would know as Zora, one of the gypsy fighters in From Russia with Love, and also Paula Caplan in Thunderball as well. So classic. You don't get more classic Bond girl than that. They're classic movies with classic Bond girls. So let's get cracking.
Okay, so our first special guest interview for today is Caroline Munro, who played, of course, Naomi in The Spy Who Loved Me. So welcome, Caroline. Lovely to have you on board.
Thank you very much. Nice to be here, but nice to be speaking to you.
Oh, thank you very much. So, yeah, welcome to James Bond Radio. We'll, I've got my good buddy Tom Sears with me. So,
hello, Tom.
Hey, Caroline. Hello, Tom. How's it going?
Very well, thank you. Lovely sunny day. So
thank you. Absolutely.
Couldn't be better.
Yeah, absolutely. So what we're going to do, we'll kick things off with our quickfire questions we always ask all of our guests. So my very first question to you today is, Caroline, what is your favourite Bond film?
My favourite Bond film would be the first one. It would be Dr. No.
Ah, okay.
Although I am a bit partial to mine, but hey.
As you should be. Cool stuff. And why is that? Is there any particular sort of thing that makes Dr. No stand out for you?
I think because it was the first and because we haven't seen anything like that, and he was so amazing as Bond. And also, you know, Sean Connery, obviously. But and also she made a wonderful entrance, didn't she, Ursula out of the water.
She
that was
did,
quite
indeed.
Spectacular. And we hadn't seen anything, so it was pretty good.
Well, that's definitely a good answer for sure. I'm not sure if you read or if you've read any of the Bond books, Caroline, but question two is, do you have a favourite James Bond novel? If you haven't read it, that's absolutely fine.
I think on Her Majesty's Secret Service would be quite an interesting one. I think it's a very, very underestimated film. You know,
absolutely.
So
good choice. That's,
yeah, in
that's
my
a
mind,
favorite
that would
of ours.
Be quite a good one.
Cool, good stuff. Now, next question is: do you have, obviously, you're an esteemed Bond girl yourself, but do you have any other favorite Bond girls?
Well, I have my lovely friend who you're going to talk to in a minute, Martine Beswick. As a personal friend, she's just amazing, and she was brilliant in the part. I like Michelle Yeoh. I loved Eva Green, and also I can never pronounce her name.
From Danny, which film?
Yes, she made a great baddie. Yeah.
Very nice. You got some
in
good choices
mind.
There.
Those would be my choices. Yes.
And following on from that, then Caroline, who is your favourite James Bond actor?
Well, I obviously my Bond was Roger Moore, and quite honestly, he was fantastic, especially in our film, in The Spy Who Loved Me, because I think he'd really made the part his own at that point. I think he was just amazing in that. Having said that, so he would be my number one, but obviously Sean Connery and the thing is with James Bond, all the actors that they chose brought a certain element, very different elements, a lot of them, to the character. So Daniel Craig has brought it right up to date, and I think he is an amazing James Bond.
Fabulous.
He really is.
So most Bond girls, they always have that answer where they say, you know, who's your favourite Bond? And they always have to go with their Bond, whoever they were
yeah,
in the film with.
My Bond so, is wonderful.
Very nice.
But for now, I think, obviously, Daniel Craig is fantastic. He's such a good actor. He has the ruggedness that I think Ian Fleming wrote about. And you kind of can believe that he would actually be able to defend himself. So
yeah.
So he would be a very close second, maybe on a par with Roger. Yeah,
well, very nice. Cool stuff. I'm sure Daniel would like to, would be happy to hear that. So next question is, of all the locations you visited during the filming of The Spy Who Loved Me, what was your favourite one? Or maybe there was more than one. Any favourite spots there?
Well, I suppose with me, I was lucky enough to go to Sardinia, to the Costa Esmeralda, which was very beautiful. But on the first few days, about 5 days, we had rotten weather. But on the sixth day when the sun came out, I mean, it was quite a spectacular, beautiful bay and wonderful hotel, wonderful locations there. And I suppose one of my favorites would be going out onto one of the many islands that are off Sardinia, and with the photographer, an Italian chap called Emilio Lari, and the view looking back to Sardinia was quite amazing. So it was a beautiful location. Other than that, I was in Pinewood, the amazing Pinewood, which has a very special place in my heart.
I guess some would say Pinewood is probably the ultimate Bond location of all of them.
It so is. I mean, I'm as far as I'm aware, it was born there, and certainly, you know, it played such a big part in so many. And in fact, our stage, the 007 stage, was built for The Spy Who Loved Me. And I don't know now if it's still one of the biggest, but it was certainly the biggest sound stage in Europe. And also it held, because it held almost full size submarines. So it was extraordinary. I mean, it was an extraordinary stage, really.
That must have been amazing amazing stage to work in. Just, I can imagine when you very first sort of walked onto it, just to see this massive stage must have been awe-inspiring.
It was so big. And then you had all the extras. You had all the men, all the, you know, the submarine crews, and then all the actors. It was really astounding. I'd never seen the sound stage as big, really. It was amazing. They had a special opening, I remember. And I think it was the Prime Minister... Harold Wilson came along. Was it Harold Wilson? No, maybe it was later than that. Actually, it wasn't Harold Wilson. It was later than that. And he came and he cut the ribbon, and then he opened the sound stage. It was very special. And it's next to the Stanley Kubrick stage. So those two are very impressive, I must say.
Very nice.
Excellent. Excellent stuff. So you were involved in a number of memorable scenes in the film. Is there any scene in particular that is a favourite of yours?
Sorry. I obviously enjoyed flying the helicopter. I liked that very much. That was great. A lot of which we did at Pinewood Studios in a helicopter. And it was a Bell Jet Ranger, so I got the chance to kind of take control. Of that, and favorite scenes, and working with Roger, you know, I suppose my first, I didn't have many scenes when I think about it, but the ones I had were with Roger and Barbara, and Roger was just delightful, so quick, so funny, very self-deprecating, and such a good actor. So you couldn't help but so I thought it, for my character, I wasn't quite sure, you know, which way to go with her. So I thought, well, I'm just going to have fun. James just brought me a nice iced glass of water, which is lovely for my throat. So I thought, well, I'll have fun, because he's obviously, Roger was up for fun with his character, with my character. So I kind of, it was like I don't know what you call it when you do the sword play, you know, backwards, forwards. Mm-hmm. I can't think what you call it. Okay, I'm rambling, I think, but no, working with Roger.
Absolutely. Sounds good. So do you have any sort of, I'm sure you've seen sort of most, if not all, the Bond films in the series. Do you have maybe a favourite scene, or maybe if not, maybe another role you would have loved to have played, maybe another Bond girl that you would have loved to have played yourself?
I like, well, Eva Green, or very, very much so. And Sophie Marceau, I think, had a wonderful role. Mm-hmm. So you know, those two would have been interesting. And I suppose maybe Honor Blackman's character too. That was quite for the time. It was kind of ahead of the time. She was great in that.
Absolutely.
So there's quite a few that would be quite, you know, feisty and fun.
So what you're saying is you'd like to go for the stronger Bond girls rather than the ones who were just window dressing.
Definitely, absolutely, and I'm sure if you spoke to most of the women, they'd say the same thing. Absolutely. I don't know, maybe they wouldn't, maybe they would, but I think so, absolutely. You want a little bit of substance, really.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's what they have now, you know, the women are absolutely, they're being written very well, the characters, and you know, strong women, strong, but still very feminine at the same time, so yeah. I think it's important to keep the femininity going.
Absolutely.
Definitely. And I'm sure they will, hopefully, into Spectre and beyond.
I'm sure they will. And I love the thought that they've got Monica, what's her name?
Bellucci.
Yes. I think, wow, what a revelation, because she's such a good actress in her own right. She's beautiful, and she's a little bit older than the average lady, average Bond lady. She looks stunning.
Yeah, it's crazy how she's never been a Bond girl before. It's almost absolutely. Like she was just born to be a Bond girl.
She's born to be a Bond girl. Yeah. Born to be a Bond girl.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah. And obviously, you know, the obvious choice too, but maybe they wouldn't do it, would be Daniel's wife. She's born to be a Bond girl too.
Rachel Weisz.
Yes, yeah, clever lady. She's just such a good actress. I mean, I'd like to see that with the two of them. Can you imagine that?
That would be quite good, I think.
It would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
So we're looking a little bit sort of in the earlier part of your career, Caroline. Was it true that you had a minor role in the 60s spoof version of Casino Royale, and how did that come about?
I wouldn't call it a role as such. I was an extra. I was an extra because they used my photographs in quite a lot of the publicity, wearing the Paco Rabanne clothes with Barbara Harris. It came about, I was a model, and I think they were casting for extras that kind of looked okay-ish, and I was one of them that went up for the casting, as well as, you know, the whole of London, basically. So there was a whole lot of us. So but I did get my taste of actually being on a film set and watching Woody Allen and David Niven, and so that I was really interested in just watching the mechanics of how it all worked. So I would ask if I could kind of sit on the side of the stage and keep very quiet and watch. And I did. So I find it a really good learning process, watching these wonderful actors work. So yes, I was an extra.
So would we see you somewhere in the background if we were to watch the film again?
Well, it's funny because somebody sent me a photograph. I mean, apart from the ones that were used in the publicity, they sent me one and they ringed it round. They put a Sharpie ring round it. And it is me with one of the guns. You know, it actually is me with my hair in a long plait. And it is me. So how they found that, whereas I couldn't see where I was. But it was me, which is amazing. Sorry?
We'll have to keep a lookout next time we
you won't see. There's so many of us there, but it was a really. I was so young too. It was a really interesting experience.
So not only that, you also worked with George Lazenby at one point as well, I believe.
I did. I did a commercial with George for Turkish Delight. This was in Spain. Golly, that was a long time ago. And I was very young. You know, early teen, mid teens, I suppose.
Yeah,
we did in Spain.
Very nice. And was he the charming chap that he comes across as all the
very
time?
Charming. He was a big fry. He was just a big fry. And I mean, I suppose you know, obviously, know about George's. You know, yes, he was a model. You know, he was a very good model and did very well at that. And so he was Mr. Big Fry, and I was just one of the ladies.
So, Caroline, you obviously mentioned Dr. No is your favourite Bond film. What is your earliest memory of James Bond? Did you watch Dr. No when it first came out, or did that come about sort of later on?
You know what? I think that definitely came about later. No, I didn't watch it when it first came out. No, I didn't. When did it first come out, actually?
62, Dr. No.
Yeah, no, I was still at school. I was still very much at school then, so I didn't see it, no.
Would you recall your earliest memory?
Of seeing it. I can't even remember where I was, whether I was at the cinema, because it wouldn't have been shown on the television, so I must have seen it in the cinema, mustn't I? But much later, I think my mum might have been a bit of a Bond fan, or a bit of a Sean Connery fan. So I think she took me to see it. I mean, you didn't have to be a certain age, did you then? I don't think.
Yeah.
Can't remember. I thought it was extraordinary because you had these wonderful locations, this beautiful man, and it just looked, it was a treat for the eyes. It looked, and it was clever. And, you know, it had a little bit of everything in it for everybody.
Yeah.
So it was a real feast.
It's a tough question, that one, because we tend to find people either have a very definite memory of the first time they were exposed to Bond.
Yeah, no, I don't remember.
Or they
awful.
Don't remember at all. And I must admit, I'm the same. For me, James Bond seems to have always been there, and I've got no memory of the first film I saw or anything like that. Yeah.
You sound very young. So what was your first Bond?
Well, thank you. I'm 33, so...
You're very young. You're very young.
Yeah.
But, a baby.
Yeah, I guess it was always on in the house. I remember watching, being too scared to watch either The Spy Loved Me or Moonraker, actually, because I was so scared of Jaws.
Really? Oh,
because so,
you were, of course, you, I mean, you were only just, you were actually, you weren't born when The Spy Loved Me.
No, that would have been 5 years before I was born, yeah.
Yeah, well, I was only about 10 when I did that film, yeah. So it's a bit precocious.
Very nice, anyway. Good stuff. Mm. So you'd had some roles in kind of those Hammer horror movies and stuff like that, and then obviously
loved
you went
them,
on to do the Spy Love Me. So how was that sort of? How did that come about? Sort of the audition for Bond and all that kind of stuff.
I had done the films, but I'd also done a lot of modeling, and I did at the time and subsequently did for 12 years a poster for a famous rum, dark rum.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really Cubby had seen the posters because they were all over, again, you're far, far too young, but they were all over the country and all over the, my dad, I remember going, he was a solicitor, and I remember he went to Waterloo and he got a terrible shock because when he came up out of the tube, there was a massive poster there of his daughter, of me,
mm-hmm.
Wearing a black wetsuit, water, completely, you know, wet, watered down,
yeah.
And with a knife strapped to my thigh. So he said, oh my gosh, he said, Carol, I've just seen the poster. Anyway, they were actually quite good posters. They were taken by brilliant photographers, and Cubby had seen one of those, and also I think he'd seen some of my other work. He'd seen Sinbad, and you know he'd actually done a bit of homework and seen some of my work, my you know, the Hammers and Sinbad and quite a few things I'd done. So I did go to meet him. And he kind of more or less offered me the part there and then of Naomi. So
wow.
How lucky was I?
Yeah, was very lucky, yeah.
Yeah, he was what a lovely man. And Barbara's done him so proud. You know, she's carrying the mantle so beautifully for Bond.
Yeah.
Clever girl.
It's one of those things, whenever we've spoken to anybody that either knew or worked with Cubby Broccoli, you never, ever hear a bad story. All you hear is just how much everybody loved him.
Oh, they absolutely, he was the nicest, gentlest man going. You know, he obviously was a businessman, but he was just, he was with his crew, and that's why they worked time and time and time again with his crew. He was just so, well, he just loved his crew, and the crew loved him, and they would work long hours for him. I mean, obviously, presumably, being a Bond, they obviously got paid well, but he really looked after them down to the boy that did the coffee.
Yeah.
You know, everybody from Lewis, who was obviously our director, to Claude Renoir, who was our lighting cameraman. Obviously, with Roger, they'd sit and play backgammon. But to everybody, and makeup people, everybody adored him because he had time for everybody. That was the thing about him. So if you have a director like that, or producer, then your crew is going to work so hard because they're going to want the same results as you do, which is obviously a good film.
Yeah.
And everybody getting on together, and he had a family. You know, his crew were his family. He was just amazing. I adored him. Really did. Lovely man. Lovely family man too.
Yeah.
You know, really good man. Lovely wife.
It's so lovely to
that
hear.
Was a joy.
Definitely. It sounds like everyone, it's almost a shame, you know, that you don't get many people like that in the film business from what you hear. You was obviously
Maybe, I don't know about now. I mean, kind of the old school, you had the Carreras, you know, again, it was like a family thing. You had, I don't know, and I've worked quite a lot in Europe with different directors and producers, and I think that either I've been very lucky in my career working with these people, or I think maybe it has changed. I don't know, but I've been very, very lucky with the people I've worked with. Absolutely.
Speaking of which, obviously you were working with Sir Roger Moore. You must have had some interesting stories or fun stories about some crazy stuff that went on set and anything like that.
Well, I can't really remember anything kind of untoward. Or I mean, we did have fun. We worked hard. When, as I say, we had the first few days and it was rotten weather. But Cuppy wasn't bothered. You know, the crew were itching to get started, but there was nothing you could do. You know, the weather was raining and it obviously wasn't right for Gond. But he kind of, again, looked after everybody. He cooked for people who cooked fantastic pastas. So I just remember that. I mean, yes, Roger, you know, Roger was, he has so much kind of charisma that and he'd make his crew laugh. And I just generally had a brilliant time. I was nervous. I was very, very nervous to be working on such a big film because, you know, the Hammer films are obviously much smaller budgets and smaller crews. So this was kind of very, very much mainstream. My other films had maybe been not as mainstream. This might be Martine arriving. Did you hear the buzzer?
We did, yeah.
You did, okay. Might be her arriving. Oh, yeah. It is. We'll see if it's Martine. It might be. Oh, I hope so. She's such a lovely... You'll love talking to her. She's brilliant. Oh, yes, it is her. I can hear her lovely voice.
You're actually our very first Bond girl we've had on the show, Caroline. So
am I?
Yeah, you are indeed.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's... I feel very honoured. Have you had some of the men or no?
No, that's the dream. Yet. That's the dream.
That's the dream to get a Bond.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's,
is it
yet.
My lovely? Are you coming? Is it you? Is it you? Is it her? It is her.
Yay.
Oh, wow. Look at your hair. It looks fantastic. This, I'm speaking to these lovely boys. Just say hello. Hello.
Hello, Martine.
Hello,
there
Martine.
She is. That's my lovely. She's just arrived. Loves her hair.
Oh, yeah?
Wow. She's had a haircut. Looks fantastic. Cool. Anyway, sorry. Natter. She's going into the kitchen.
Okay.
Too much information. Sorry.
No worries. It's all good. So, what was it like working with Lewis Gilbert? What kind of director was he to work with?
Oh, they were. He and Hilda. What a brilliant chap. And of course, I don't know if at that time had he done Educating Rita. Can't remember. Can you?
You I think probably he know had. That, Chris, better than I would.
I think he had done that.
I think he had, but his kind of reputation for all his work, he was so down to earth and so charming and very kind of gentle. You know, you just have a quick word and he you kind of knew if it wasn't going right, then he would say something. You know, he kind of just... We didn't do many takes, which was great because I don't like to do that many takes particularly because I think very often your first or second take are more true because it's the first time, second time you're saying it. So, but that's just me. I mean, other directors maybe think differently, but I think that's very personal. But he was wonderful to work with, so sweet. And they looked after me when I was in New York, when I went to the premiere with Kurt Jurgens, and he and his wife Hilda and Cubby and Dana, they all looked after me so well at my first time in New York. So it's just brilliant. And the thing is with a Bond film, they absolutely treat you so beautifully. Everything is just... when Richard Kiel, my lovely Richard Kiel, my lovely friend, when we did the European premieres, Richard and myself. We went round all around Europe doing the premieres.
What was the kind of the publicity tours around? Because a lot of actors, they love to, you know, they love to do the acting, but the publicity side of things, all the tours and interviews, they don't particularly like all that much. So what was that like for you, that experience?
Oh, it was wonderful. I mean, it couldn't have been nicer because we went to all the different countries. It was hard work. Having said that, it was really hard work. I mean, we were flown around with families and, you know, our families. We were flown to all the various places. You had to do the press junkets, which were a lot of press, a lot of photographs, a lot of interviews, televisions. But we were, you know, stayed in amazing hotels. And so it was all part of it, really. And it was, even though it was quite hard work, it was still quite gentle because it was the way Cubby did it. Yeah. And again, I was lucky enough to go to New York for the New York premiere and do the television and stuff with Richard and Kurt Jurgens. I suppose being the baddie team, and Roger, I don't know what Barbara, I'm not sure if Roger was with Barbara, Barbara Bach, I'm not sure, but I know Roger did a lot, obviously.
Richard Kiel seems
all kind of stuck together.
Yeah, Richard Kiel seems like one of the nicest guys ever. I met him once, and he was just so chatty and so down to earth and so lovely.
Where did you meet him?
There was a screening over in LA actually, and there was like a little Q and A afterwards. And considering I literally didn't watch his two films for years when I was a kid because he scared me so much, he was just so lovely. It was quite weird to see, really.
Complete gentle giant, and so clever. The thing with Richard, he was such a clever writer and such a clever chap, very, very intellectual, but again, very down to earth and very family man with Diane and the boys and everything. So it's just... I was so shocked and so sad, and when I heard, I couldn't believe it. We always had such a great time. We'd meet in Los Angeles, we'd meet all over the place, and we'd do the various, signing shows together or just get the publicity or whatever. But he was a joy to work with. We did a show with him in Las Vegas, I remember. In fact, he asked me, he said, will you come over and do it with me? I took my two daughters, and he had Diane, had his wife, and we did it. It was actually a Star Trek convention. They had Leonard Nimoy and had all these amazing people, but they also had some Bond people. So Richard suggested I came. And then I remember we all went out to dinner, and we went to his favorite place, which was called Marie Callender's House of Pies, to have a pudding. So he took us there, and the people couldn't believe that he was coming through the door, and they made such a fuss. So it was brilliant. He was lovely, very simple, very just a clever but very family simple. Simple life and just a good life, just a good man.
Aww.
Yeah.
Lovely to hear. So now, obviously, the term sort of Bond girl has been around for years and years and years now. Would you consider yourself sort of part of a special group along with the other Bond girls? And how much do you think Bond has had an impact on your career since The Spy Who Loved Me?
Well, I feel very... lucky enough to, when they do the various Bond things, to be included, even though I had a small part. It's nice to be included in the Bond ladies. I think we did a MasterChef, I don't know, a couple of years ago, and Martine and myself did it. Brit was there. There were quite a few Bond ladies, Eunice Gayson. So there were a lot of us there. Fiona Fullerton was there, and Jenny Hanley, and so yes, when we get together and we do, if we go to America and you do the Hollywood publicity thingies, it's just wonderful, and they're all very individual and very special ladies. Mm-hmm. All the ones I've met, they have a uniqueness. I don't know what it is. It's kind of a, I don't know what it is though, but they were all. Cubby did it right. He kind of chose, of the old school ladies. I haven't met any of the new ones, I must say, but I'm sure they're just as lovely and delightful as the older ladies.
So speaking of conventions, you're going to be appearing next week, aren't you, at the Mid-Atlantic Nostalgia Convention.
Along with Sophie Martin, myself, and Lee Majors. Bionic Man, and also the Bionic Lady, Lindsay Wagner. And we're in, where are we in? Baltimore. We're at the Hunt Valley Hotel, I think, in Maryland. Like that. From the 17th to the 19th of September.
That's right, so we're there next weekend.
Yeah, next weekend.
Cool stuff.
We move on to Saturday.
For any listeners who wants to go along and meet Caroline and maybe get an autograph and that kind of stuff, make sure you grab a ticket.
That would be lovely. That'd be lovely to see. You know, you can just come along for a chat. You don't have to get anything, but just come along for a chat would be great.
Absolutely. Good stuff. Well, thank you so much for spending some time with us today, Caroline. So last question is where can our listeners find out more about you? Do you have a website or anything like that going on?
I do have a website. Well, I'll have to just hold on for a second.
Okay.
Sorry, what's my website? I know I should know it. Oh, carolinemunro.org. That's my website. Sorry, I just bought myself a little. Oh, I don't know. I'm on a Facebook too. The Facebook. And I do it with Jane. Sometimes.
Very nice.
Jane's very good on that. So yes, that's me.
CarolineMunro.org, and you're on Facebook too. Good stuff.
I am. Okay, thank you. Stuff. Thank you very much. Lovely to talk to you.
Lovely to talk to you too. Thank you very much.
Yes, they've mentioned the convention. Yes. Yes, they have. Jane was just saying yes.
Good
we
stuff.
Have.
All right. Well, thank you for your time, Caroline.
Thanks
Caroline.
Cool. See you then. Take care.
Thank you
Bye-bye.
Very much. Bye.
Chris, I'm not sure if you're aware, but we just interviewed Naomi on James Bond Radio.
Did we? That's funny because I thought I just had a dream. I was like asleep and I thought I dreamt that we interviewed Naomi from...
Just had exactly the same dream. We've just had a real live Bond girl on the podcast, Chris. I'm not sure. I'm all flummoxed. I don't even know what to say.
Well, blow my balls with... lollipops. I don't know. That's amazing.
Blow my balls with lollipops. That's a new one. I've not heard that before.
No, me neither. But wow. I mean, how cool, how lovely was Caroline?
Like, how lovely was she, man?
Amazing. Amazing. And yeah, beautiful, lovely, lovely woman. I love it when you find out that people who've been involved with Bond are really not just proud of the fact, but they've got, you know, they know all about it.
Yeah.
They're proper into Bond. And she was a Bond fan.
Yeah.
And that is awesome to hear.
That's one of those things, isn't it? Because there's this, that like common perception with actors that like when they're in something huge, they like to distance themselves from it as much as they can afterwards. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, I imagine if you went up to Connery and asked him about Bond, he probably wouldn't be up for talking about it all that much. So it's
probably
lovely
not,
when you chat to somebody who's, you know, she's a classic Bond girl. You don't, you know, she's right up there. And it's lovely to hear all those stories and just sort of how fun and excited she was to talk about it all. And Roger sounds like a dude, doesn't he? As does
he
Cubby,
does.
As
Roger
does Richard
like
Kiel.
All of them involved is brilliant, isn't it? Sounds good.
Well, I don't know whether you're aware, Chris, but that's not the only interview today. We've got another Bond girl coming on the show. I don't know whether you knew that. Did you know that?
I thought our format was like one person interviews. I don't think we've ever done a
Usually
that, have
we haven't. No, yeah. Usually it's one person. But not only have we got a double barrel interview, it's with the double barrel Bond girl, Chris.
What?
See
That's
if you
like
can guess
double
who
barrel,
it is.
Double barrel, double barrel, double barrel,
quadruple
oh,
barrel.
Oh my goodness! It's like, let me have a guess. Could her initials begin with MB?
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. Woo-hoo. Next up, we have none other than Martine Beswick, who is in not one, but two James Bond films, From Russia With Love and Thunderball. Let me just repeat
That's
that. From Russia With Love and Thunderball, two of the most classic Bond films in the whole series, right back there at the beginning of the whole journey. Sean's still in his prime. He's not got bored and sick of Bond yet. He's not got the ump for being so famous. He's right up there at the pinnacle of his bondage. And we've got one of his Bond girls to talk to. Are you excited? Because I know I am.
I've gone through three layers already. It's gonna be exciting. I can't wait.
Excellent stuff. So, without further ado, then let's say hello to Martine Beswick. So our second Bond girl interview of the day is with double barrel Bond girl Martine Beswick, star of From Russia With Love and Thunderball. Welcome to James Bond Radio, Martine.
No, thank you. Thank you. Very nice to be here.
It's lovely to have you. So we're going to start things off with our quickfire questions. And the very first one is, what is your favourite Bond film?
Actually, interestingly enough, I think that Russia with From Russia with Love was a really probably one of the best films of all the series. I think it was a really, really terrific film. However, I mean, I like a lot of them. I mean, I liked the first one. I thought the first one was really terrific. I liked Thunderball. I like mine. But I think From Russia with Love was actually not just my favorite, but really the best, actually.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very good.
Oh, thank you, darling. I've just received a little glass.
That's glass of bubbly. Good stuff.
Mm. And our second quickfire question then, Martine. I don't know if you've read any, but do you have a favourite James Bond book at all?
I never read them. Huh? Nope. Never read any. In fact, I didn't. Really bizarre. I had no idea about James Bond, even though I'm Jamaican and lived there. But I left when I was quite young, and I had no idea until I went up for a part.
Wow.
So how old were you when you, well, so what year would it have been when you left Jamaica then?
I was about 12, no, okay. Almost 13. Oh, and okay. I came to London. So, I mean, I had no idea.
So that was way before Dr. No then?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, way before. Oh, long.
Good stuff. So do you have a, obviously you're like we said, double barrel Bond girl, played two different characters in two different films, but do you have any other favorite Bond girls that you're particularly, particularly like?
I love the Bond girls. I think they're like sisters. They're like all my sisters. I have to say that Caroline's my favorite sister.
Very nice.
Isn't that funny? She said the same about you.
No, I absolutely adore her. I mean, we're like two peas in a pod. We love hanging out together. We love doing stuff together. If she's going somewhere, or in fact, we would like to be anywhere together. We'd really do.
That's nice. And now, do you have, obviously, you've been in two Bond films with the same Bond actor, but do you have a favourite actor who's portrayed James Bond?
I'm sorry, it's Sean. It's definitely Sean, actually. I mean, I just think he had, there was something about him that really, he was really masculine and male and gorgeous. I mean, really handsome, and there was a sexuality about him. I mean, I didn't fancy him. We were pals. But I thought he was really terrific. I mean, he was really magnetic on screen.
Yeah. I think you're probably the first person I have ever spoken to who said they didn't fancy Sean Connery.
Well, I really loved playing with him. I mean, he was really fun to play with because he was really mischievous and it was just really fun. But it was just not... it just wasn't the other, you know.
Yeah,
it wasn't anything to do with, you know. I don't know. He wasn't my type.
Not your cup of tea.
That way. No.
Good stuff. So during your time working on the Bonds, you got to go to some pretty amazing locations. So is there any sort of particular favorite locations that you got to go to for the filming?
Oh, my God. Oh, let's face it. Thunderball was the most amazing location ever. I mean, it was 4 months, I mean, sorry, 2 months in Nassau.
Wow.
It was absolutely incredible. And it was also, you know, directed by and helmed by Terence Young, who was one of the most fantastic, a man who loved life, a man who liked the best things in life, and so therefore spoiled us all.
Yeah.
And it was just the most fabulous, fabulous location. Really, really incredible. Very great fun. A lot of work, but really terrific. Really terrific. It was something that I'll never ever forget. Ever.
Very nice. So when you were shooting From Russia with Love, I guess it was there was a lot of studio time rather than out on location, or.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're supposed to go to Turkey and, you know, all set to go. And then they decided to do it on the back lot of Pinewood. So I got gypped out of a out of a little travel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you been back to Nassau since filming Thunderball?
Oh, no. I have too many other places to visit.
So, obviously, you were in quite a number of memorable scenes. Is there any scene you were involved in which is your favourite?
Well, I thought the fight was really terrific in From Russia With Love. And we rehearsed it for, what was it, 3 weeks. I mean, it was sort of set up like it was actually sort of choreographed like a dance, because what Terence wanted to do was come in close, was use a handheld and really kind of get in close and sort of really make it in a really interesting fight. And it did. It was. And I thought it was a really terrific fight. Really yeah. Terrific.
Yeah, certainly one of the most memorable scenes in the film. That's
yeah,
sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good stuff. So out of all of the other Bond films, I'm sure you've probably seen them all, but or most of them, do you have a particular favourite scene? That's a very tricky question, I know.
Oh God, there are so many. Actually, I tell you what's interesting, it's not so much a scene, but I was never, I mean, you know, when Daniel Craig came on, he didn't really, because I was so much a Sean fan that it was hard to accept. I quite liked, who else did I like? I thought Roger was lovely, but I really, there was not a lot of people that really got me, you know, that really got me. But I have to say, and I wasn't particularly fond of Daniel Craig, but I have to say Skyfall was a really terrific film.
Okay.
Really terrific. And I mean, as a film, not just as a Bond film, but as a film with the script and the whole thing, it was a really, really, really good film. Really good.
Cool. Very nice. So you mentioned you sort of weren't really aware of James Bond before, you know, you got involved with the series yourself. So how did that work kind of when you were first approached to kind of audition and all that kind of stuff? Sort of, you know, where were you in life at that point and kind of how did it come about?
It's a really silly thing, actually, because I was in Jamaica and I was there for about a couple of years. I'd gone back to Jamaica when I was about 17. And there was an American producer who came down looking for his little star. And there was a whole sort of thing about, you know, asking all the girls to come and interview. And he really wanted people, he wanted a new girl and a new face. And I got chosen out of all the girls that came by. So, and he was, I mean, who knows what he did afterwards? I have no idea. But he was a very, very nice man. And he just thought that I was, you know, the cat's whiskers. And he I ended up being there for the weekend on the North Coast, you know, on the sand in a teeny weeny, it was a teeny weeny polka dot bikini, which got lots of coverage. And he took this film of me sort of prancing around and being mad and gay. Mm. And he took it back and he took it around with him. And he took it to London to MCA. And I had no idea what MCA was. MCA was the biggest agency probably in the world.
Yeah.
But I had not a clue. I was green, very, very green. Anyway, I got a letter from them when I was still in Jamaica. And said, we understand, we've seen film on you and we'd really like to meet you when you come in. And I thought, okay, and I stuck it away. And then I went back to England, probably not long after, probably within the year. And sure enough, I called them, went in to see them. And it was really strange because I was sitting, there I was, completely green, having not really done anything except little films, you know, modeling and little films in Jamaica. And I'm sitting in this huge room with all these, about at least 12 suits around this table, and they're all kind of chattering about me, and I'm sitting there thinking, oh my God, what is this?
Yeah.
Anyway, they all sort of had this conversation. They said, well, you know, I'm the James Bond, and I think we should, yes, and I still had no idea. Anyway, they set up an appointment, and I went to see Terence. I met parents. And he looked at me and he said, well, you're not right for honey. And you need to go and get yourself, go and get some, go off and do some work. He did. And I sort of looked at him and he was actually, he suddenly sort of turned into my dad,
yeah.
You know, in a way. And he said, go on, go off and get some experience. He said, because I have an idea what I want. And sure enough, I mean, we met after that socially. And he said, you're going to be one of my gypsy girls.
Very nice.
And that was it. I mean, so I was spoiled to begin with. I mean, because I never had to go through any of that awful, that horrible thought of the couch, you know. Whatever that
casting couch thing, yeah.
I never had to go through that because, and what he said went. I mean, he made a suggestion and a promise, and sure enough, he fulfilled it. And he became one of my dearest friends, really, really great friends. I just adored him, absolutely. One of the most elegant men I have ever known. Absolutely lovely.
A lot of people have said that he was almost a James Bond type figure himself.
Absolutely, absolutely. And he had a really mischievous sense of humor. I mean, he and Sean were very, you know, they were mischief together.
Imagine there's a lot of fun on set while you were working with them.
Yes, yeah.
Now, going back to your the wrestling scene from Russia with Love, it's obviously quite a memorable one. Do you recall, was there a sort of a reaction to it in the media? And was it a fun scene to film as well?
It was. It was really great. I mean, it was a terrific scene to film. And I then got to be, suddenly I became Battling Beswick. And there was this huge thing. I mean, it was Terry O'Neill who did a whole fantastic picture. I still have the picture somewhere. And he did this huge thing, and it was in the sort of center page of some newspaper. I can't remember whether it was the Mirror or one of those, Our Express, one of those at the time. And there was this huge double thing, and it was Battling Beswick. And it happened, you know, because after that I did other fights. And it was Battling Beswick Strikes Again. So, yes, I became Battling Beswick.
Very nice, cool stuff. So, kind of fast forward a couple of years then, obviously you were asked back for kind of Thunderball, mm-hmm. and you had a much bigger part that time. So what was that kind of like with kind of transitioning from the smaller part to the bigger part? And obviously there was like a big change in Bond between those years as well, relatively small with From Russia and then huge by the time Thunderball came along. So what was that like, that transition?
Well, the thing about it was that actually Thunderball was like at the zenith of Bond. It had hit, I mean, it was so much so that all the people that we were in, when we were in Nassau, the entire world came down, including, I mean, all the fans arrived, the most incredibly rich people came down in their yachts. I mean, everyone came to this, and every newspaper, magazine, radio, TV, and it was just a party from morning, noon, and night, really. Yeah. It was incredible. It was absolutely incredible. I mean, I probably did more publicity than I was on screen.
Wow.
It was like every minute that I was free, it was publicity for every magazine.
That's something.
I mean, it was Milk, Life, Cosmopolitan, I mean, you name it, every magazine was there.
So that was something we just asked Caroline, actually, is a lot of actors you hear, they love, you know, acting and the actual process of making the movie, but the press that perhaps comes with it is perhaps not as much fun as that. What was that like for you with all the, you know, the travel and all that kind of stuff, the promotional side of things? Was that fun or not so much?
It was fine. It was almost like part of the part.
Right.
You know, yeah. I mean, it was what one did. I suppose it was expected, but it was also, we understood that this was what was going to happen because of where Bond was at this point. It was just it was insane, absolutely insane. So it was fine. It was absolutely fine. I actually, you know, it was part of the job. Yeah. That's what it was.
Cool.
Yeah.
How did you, in Thunderball, how did you find working with your fellow Bond girls, with Domino and Lucia?
Oh, I love them. I mean, yeah. Actually what's interesting is that, you know, with all the sort of idea of women being bitchy with each other, not at all. I'd never experienced that at all. And in fact, I haven't seen... actually, Claudine and I were really close, but she disappeared. I've never seen her since. But Luciana and I are great friends, and so is Molly.
Oh, that's good.
So we're all really close. And I just saw Luciana, actually. She was in Norway with me. And I just adore her, absolutely adore her.
They probably all saw your wrestling skills, so they all had to behave themselves, I would imagine.
Now I'm afraid those days are over.
Good stuff.
And so obviously you worked with both Terrence and Sean in From Russia and Thunderball. Do you have any sort of memorable stories from either shoot regarding working with those two?
Oh god, there's so many. I think probably one of the things that if we start playing after we've done a scene and suddenly, all of a sudden, Sean and in fact, there are photographs proving this, Sean and I would start dancing, and we'd start humming and dancing, you know, there we are, sort of doing our sort of like little Strictly dance. And suddenly, you know, Terrence would go, children, stop that, it's time to work, you know. So that was sort of the how it was.
Yeah.
That it was fun, but it was also hard work, and you better get down and do it.
Sounds like a good time to be had on set there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you're what we would call a classic Bond girl. You know, you've been in two of the biggest and best Bond films of all time. And what is that experience like? I imagine that follows you around everywhere you go for as long as you live, won't it? That kind of thing.
It is. I mean, as Marion Biabo said in her book, which she was lovely. What a lovely book she put out. It's called Bond Girls Are Forever. Mm. And it's the truth. It's the truth. I mean, I just saw her, actually. I saw her, and we were together in Norway. And in fact, the name of the weekend that we were there, it was the 50th anniversary of Thunderball. Excuse me. And it was also... a UNICEF, a charity, and it was just being with these ladies is amazing, and there is a real bond because it's an experience. It is really, I know, and it's an experience that we all can relate to because we've all had very similar experiences on the shoots that we've done, on the films that we've done. So yeah.
Do you remember when the phrase Bond girl originally came out? Was it around when From Russia was made, or when Thunderball was made, or is it more modern phrase than that?
Thunderball, I think.
Thunderball.
I can't remember actually, but I think it even started before that. I think it started with Ursula, who, by the way, I thought was absolutely. I mean, what an image that was.
Mm-hmm.
Modern. Amazing.
Yeah.
Truly iconic. So you're going to be appearing at the Mid-Atlantic Nostalgia Convention as well next weekend, aren't you?
Yes, I'm really looking forward to it. Really looking forward to it.
Good stuff. So if any of our listeners want to pop along and meet Martine and Caroline as well and get autographs and all that kind of stuff, you're going to be there from the 17th to the 19th, is that right?
Yes. We're going to be, it's 3 days. So it's, I think, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And I think it's going to be really terrific. And in fact, somebody else is going to be there that I worked with, the Majors.
Very nice.
Yeah. And I did several shows with him, actually. So that would be fun to see. I haven't seen him for a long time, so that would be really fun to see. I think it's going to be a really great show. I'm really, really looking forward to it. And and being with my signing family, as I call them. You know, these are friends that kind of come together. We can hardly wait to get together and have fun.
Yeah,
sounds great. And just finally then, Martine, where can our listeners find out more about you? Do you have a website or an online Facebook profile or anything like that?
I'm afraid I'm a really horribly lazy woman. I just can't. I really can't. I mean, there is a Facebook page, but I do not do it. Basically, there is a friend of mine who sort of looks at it and takes, you know, is in charge.
Yeah.
And if anything comes up, then he'll just send me the, you know, he'll just send them on to me. But I'm not, I'm really, I'm horrible. I'm a horrible woman.
So if people really want to find out more, then they should go to the convention.
Exactly. That's what they're for. That's what it's for.
There you go.
Yeah. That's what it, and I'm really, and I love meeting people. So, you know, that to me is so much better than trying to, you know, email or whatever, or talk on the phone, or no. This is, it's so much nicer to meet people. That one of the things that I really love about these conventions is that you actually, we actually really enjoy meeting our fans. We really do. We love our fans.
Good stuff.
That's what we love to hear.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Martine. You and Caroline are our first ever Bond girls we've had on the show, so we're truly honoured to have you. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. It's been really, really lovely. Thank you so much for having me.
It's been
lovely to have you on the show. I'm sure all of our listeners will all really enjoy listening back to the interviews as well.
Good stuff.
Fantastic.
Okay, then. Well, thanks for coming on the show, and hopefully we will see you soon.
Yeah. And
thank you very much.
I hope the convention goes well. Thanks.
Oh, it will. We'll have fun no matter what. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
So, Tom, are you awake?
I just had this amazing dream that we just interviewed Martine Beswick, Chris.
Another one. I mean, so first Caroline and now Martine. What's going on? Are we drinking something strange in our water? I don't know.
I'm having a little bit of a moment, Chris. I'll be honest with you. I'm having a little bit of a moment because, like, when we started James Bond Radio, it was just you and me talking about films, and now we've actually managed to speak. We've had our first two Bond girls on the actual podcast, and I'm having a little bit of a moment to myself, you know, getting a little bit emotional. I'm going to probably shed a couple of tears. What about you?
Again,
how lovely is Martine? Like,
yeah,
amazing.
Amazing. They're like so friendly. Again, she knew like load about Bond. Obviously, really loved being a Bond girl and part of that whole family. And what I love as well is that, you know, she was sort of saying how much both her, Caroline, and I assume like a load of the others really want to speak to the fans and everything like that. You know, it's not a case of keeping their distance. It's like, come on, we'll have a chat, we'll get together and have good time sort of thing. So yeah, brilliant interview.
Lovely. I loved hearing all those stories. And again, you know, going right back to the beginning with From Russia With Love, that gypsy fight is such an iconic moment that's talked about. Can you imagine how kind of like cutting edge that would have been for the times as well? Yeah. You know, even I remember there was like GoldenEye was trimmed down, wasn't it? But one of the fights between Xenia and Natalia, because it was violence between women. Oh, it's a bit frowned upon. So going right back to 63 and having a full on ruck. A scantily clad ruck as well for 1963. That's quite a big deal, isn't it?
It sure is, and one that we certainly enjoyed as well.
Yeah,
big time. Which is pretty good.
So, from the bottom of our hearts, thank you to Caroline and Martine for coming on the show. Real live Bond girls. What a joy! What a treat!
Amazing, and they've left us with a nice, warm, fuzzy feeling inside.
Absolutely, so, good stuff.
Know, just beautiful, lovely people. Great stuff.
So, Chris, that brings us around to answer our Bond trivia questions of the day. Are you ready, Chris?
I am ready. Are you ready, Tom?
I hope so. That's all I'm going to say. I hope so.
Okay. So my question was, what can you name? How many different gambling games can you name from the Bond series, and in what films did they occur?
Okay. Dr. No.
Quite a few answers.
He played.
All right.
Dr. No, he plays Chemin de Fer at the beginning.
Brilliant. Fantastic.
He also plays solitaire or patience while he's waiting for Professor Dent.
Excellent stuff.
I think that's it for Dr. No.
Superb.
From Rush with Love, can't think of any. Is there any in From Rush with Love?
No, I haven't got any from Rush with Love, actually.
Goldfinger, I can't think of any.
Goldfinger, it doesn't necessarily mean that he was playing it.
Okay, so that would be Goldfinger at the beginning, and he'd be playing Blackjack?
Not quite.
Oh, what is it then?
Gin Rummy.
Gin, of course it is, because he says gin when he puts his cards down. All right, mm-hmm. Gin Rummy it is. Can't think of anything in Thunderball.
Casino scene.
Oh, yeah, of course. Would that be Shemander Fair again?
Spectre of Defeat? Yeah, Shemander Fair, yeah.
So do I have to go through every movie and just name every
No, I wasn't going to do it like that. Oh, okay, I was going to say Shemander Fair, what films
was
that
in? We're going to be here all day. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
let's go with Shemander Fair. What films do you know, what films did he play that in? So you got Dr. No, you got Thunderball.
Oh, man, that's a tough one. I don't think I can give you.
But all right, don't worry about it.
I'll tell you what, if I give you the names of the games and then...
Yeah, okay, and we'll do it that way. Okay, sounds good.
So in Diamonds Are Forever, he would play... He'd play craps.
Brilliant. Superb. Well done.
And in Octopussy, what would that be with the dice?
It was also sixes. The favorite game. Yes, good man, brilliant,
nice,
love it.
And the rest, I'm just going to say. Oh, obviously Texas Hold'em in Casino Royale.
Yes, excellent stuff.
That I'm all out of ideas now.
Okay, no, that's really respectable. That's awesome. So Shemander Fair, he plays in Dr. No, which you got, and Patience, which I love because that's good. He also played that in Thunderball. Other casino scenes that he played it were on Her Majesty's Secret Service and For Your Eyes Only. Now, there's a different thing here because he also played it in GoldenEye. And I'll tell you why there's something that's a bit strange about that, which I'll go to in a minute. Gin Rummy, obviously, he saw Goldfinger play, but he also played with Solitaire at the end when on the train. Diamonds Are Forever, he got craps, which is great. Now, in The Man with the Golden Gun, when he's in the sort of Hong Kong casino thing, the gambling is called Sick Bo.
Ah, okay. I wouldn't have got that one.
I didn't know that myself. Yeah, I had to research that one. You got Backgammon Octopussy, brilliant. In License to Kill, he plays Blackjack. He's at the Blackjack table, License to Kill. Electra plays One Card Draw. In The World Isn't Enough, it's not really a gambling game. And obviously, you've got Texas Hold'em, which is brilliant. Now, the interesting thing about the GoldenEye one is that Xenia refers to them playing Baccarat.
Yeah.
Now, Shemander Fair is a variation of Baccarat, but they are not the same thing. Now, the sort of small variance in it is that when you play Shemander Fair, it's the players that deal the cards. So one of the players is the banker, and they deal out the cards to each other. Whereas in Baccarat, the actual casino is the banker, and so the casino funds the bank, and so people play against that. Whereas in Shemander Fair,
the
casino is only there. Yeah, the casino is only there to be a location and to provide the equipment that they use.
Interesting.
And in each of Bond's scenes, including one in GoldenEye against Xenia, it's always the players that use the cards. So he hasn't actually played Baccarat before. It's always been Shemander Fair.
So that's why they always pass the shoe. Because it's not the banker's job. Yeah. Interesting. Exactly. Good knowledge, Chris. I tell you what, though, that is one of my one things that I wish they'd have done in Casino Royale. Texas Hold'em Poker is not a Bond card game, as far as I'm concerned. I would have much rather seen him play Shemander Fair, like one of those classic old school card games. Do you know what I mean?
Would that have worked with the audience? I mean, I agree. I think it would have been amazing, but it's just a modern day audience probably wouldn't have got
it. I totally get why they went with Texas Hold'em. for that reason, but it would have just been nice to just hear the word Baccarat in a Bond film again. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. That would be lovely. Yeah. Even though we've just learned that he doesn't really play Baccarat, he prefers a bit of Chemin de Fer. But but there we go.
Do you think we'll see a Bond gambling inspector?
I don't think we will, because we've seen him, you know, he, obviously gambling was a big part of Casino. It was a big part of, it was certainly a scene in Skyfall, wasn't it, in the casino there. So I think we're probably going to get a little rest from that this time around.
Yeah.
I suppose the key Bond scenes, aren't they, that keep cropping up are snow scenes and diving scenes, which we obviously haven't had for a little while. So, yeah, we'll see how that develops when we watch the film next month. Next month, Chris. Next month.
I know. Next month. That's crazy, isn't it? Crazy.
Anyway, my Bond trivia question today is as follows. Oh, God, yes. In what films do we see Bond using a throwing knife?
Right. Okay. Now, let me think. It's a very good question, this.
Thank you.
Now, I know in Thunderball, there's a flat throwing knife in the suitcase, which he uses to stab into Red Grant's arm before he uses his watch to strangle him. In From Russia with Love. Very did I say Thunderball?
You did.
Sorry, I don't know why I said that. Yeah, sorry, in From Russia with Love. I don't think he uses one Goldfinger. Does he use... He must use a diving knife in a Thunderball at some point, but I don't think that's the same thing as a flowing knife, is it?
Well, what I'm looking for is seeing him actually throw a knife.
Okay.
Or using a throwing knife. So you're From Russia with Love one, even though he doesn't throw it, is still a throwing knife, isn't it? That's what it's meant for.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah.
Along those lines.
So, and it's got to be Bond that does it. Yep. So in obviously in Spot, You Only Live Twice, did he ever do a Ninja Star himself? I'm not sure. Does that count or not?
That doesn't count. That's a Ninja Star.
Okay. Cause it's a Ninja Star. Okay. Well, obviously Octopussy, he definitely does when he's fighting, Mishka and Grishka and he takes one of their knives and uses that.
So yeah. That's one.
So that's Thunderball. I keep saying that. So that's From Russia with Love and Octopussy. What other times does he use a knife? He uses one in Honor Majesty's to get the date in Draco's office.
I'm superstitious.
That's awesome. That's such a good scene.
But today is the 13th.
So good. That film's awesome. Okay, so there's that one. Let's have a think. Does he use any other knives? How many am I missing? Are there quite a few?
I can think of one more. There might be more. JBR listeners across the world are currently screaming into their headphones because they've thought of more, obviously, but I can think of one more. You got From Rush for Love, you got Octopussy, you got Majesties. I can think of one more. Let me know if you want a clue. I'm going to have to start the countdown clock soon, Chris.
Okay, yeah, give us a clue then.
You will have seen this recently.
Okay, so it's either Moonraker or Spy. So if I'm thinking one of them... Which one? Does he use one? Can't think. Does he use one in Moonraker? No.
He does use one in Moonraker.
Yeah.
Can you think of when he would use one in Moonraker? It was this particular one that inspired the question, actually, for today's trivia.
Was it really?
Mm.
Right, let's think. Of course it is.
Go on.
The funeral boat, when he gets a knife and chucks
there
it back at the guy and goes in the coffin. Of course it is.
Yeah. Very nice.
That's good.
Well done.
You're not sure about it.
So those are the four I could think of. If there are any JBR listeners out there who can think of any more where you see Bond using a throwing knife, then get in touch.
Pierce or Timmy Boy?
That's a good
question. Really good question.
Absolutely. So, moving on, it is time for the Guess the Quote round.
Bon, 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 bon. James Bond.
Very nice. Now, it was my quote last time, and I'm very proud of it too. So I will perform it for you again, Chris. My quote from last week was...
Yes.
Give me that. Any ideas on that one?
Funnily enough, when I heard it last time, there was a flicker or something, but I didn't have it. I didn't get it initially. But after I played it in my head again, I had a good idea. But could you do it once more for us, please?
Give me that.
With the masculine tone that you're speaking, I think it might be Miss Andrea Anders from The Man with the Golden Gun.
Absolutely right. And can you remember what scene?
Yeah, it's when they're in the Peninsula Hotel when Bond's just snuck into a room and he's looking at the golden bullets in the cigarette case.
Very nice.
And then she just catches him when she's on the phone.
I think, there you are. She? Good stuff. Congratulations, yeah. Chris. Cool. Full marks for you this week. Well done.
That was a good quote. All right. Would you like to hear my new quote?
Yes, please. I'm excited. Now, by your little cheeky grin, I imagine this is going to be an amusing one.
No, it's not. It's not. I don't know. Maybe I should have gone with a better one. But anyway, this is my quote of the week. Mm-hmm. I can't find the break.
That is a good one. Ah, do it again.
Does it ring? Okay. I can't find the break. Does that ring any bells?
It does.
Not?
It rings massive bells. But for some reason, I can't lock onto it right now. There's going to be one of those that jumps into my head very soon.
Yeah.
Sure. But good. Good work. Nice cool. one. Excellent work. Yeah, cool. So we had a listener quote last time from Mr. Bernard Custodio, which was this one.
Stop teasing me.
Now that one has got us both a bit stumped, hasn't it, Chris? We don't yeah. know what that is, and sadly we haven't heard from Bernard yet. So Bernard, if you can send in the answer to that one, we will play it on the show, and please do, because it's one of those that's kind of like it's playing on our minds at night time, isn't it, Chris? We get snuggled down in bed and that's what jumps into our brains and it won't let us go to sleep.
We get snuggled down in bed.
We certainly do, in the spoon position. I like to be the baby spoon. You like to be the big spoon. And
naturally.
Yeah. Okay. Very nice. So, yes, get in touch, Bernard. We would like to know what the answer to that quote was. Now, this week we have a quote from long-time JBR listener, Matthew Grice. He's back. Grice is back with a new quote. So let's see what he's got for us this time.
Hello, this is a long-time JBR listener, Matthew Grice, just ringing up to say that I'm still an avid listener and a great fan of the show. Keep up the good work. I thought I'd just ring up and leave a quote. So here is the quote. I have a small favour to ask. Hope you get it. Good luck and keep up with the good work. Cheers. Bye.
So, Chris, any ideas on that one?
It is definitely ringing some bells, but I'm not 100% sure yet.
Yeah, it's I'm the same. One. I know I've heard that phrase. I have a small favour to ask. It's eluding me.
Good one.
Yeah, that is a good one.
Good one, Gricey.
Thank you, Mr. Gricey Pants. Looking forward to hearing the answer to that next week. So that brings us on to the latest round of... Guest music cue. This round, Chris serves up a little short nugget clip of one of the Bond scores, and we have to guess what it is. So, Chris, what have you got for us?
So, I'm going to play the same one that we played last week, for anyone who wants to hear it again, and then see if they can get it right. So, here is last week's guest music cue. I love that piece of music so much. It's one of my favorite bits of music. So any ideas? What do you think?
I know that piece of music very well. Octopussy.
Yes. Which, any idea of what scene or?
Is it the pre-title sequence when he's walking around in costume as Mr. Toro? Yeah.
Yeah, excellent stuff. Exactly where it is. I love that scene. Oh, come on. Oh, Octopussy's coming soon. I love that scene and I love that music. It's so good. But yeah, that's exactly where it's from.
Do you know what I'm excited about? I'm excited about these next three Roger movie reviews because these are ones I haven't watched in a long time. So it's going to be proper rediscovery for me, these next three. I hope they really are. It's going to be good.
It's going to be cool.
So, you got a new one for us this time?
We have indeed, yep. So, my one for this week. Now, I think you probably have a good chance in this one. But, again, it's quite a cool piece of music, this one. But, yeah, let's have a listen. And if anyone has an idea, you can let us know. And we'll find out if you're right next week.
Let's have a listen.
Yeah,
So we'll obviously reveal the answer to that one next time. But to continue on today's Ultimate James Bond quiz show, which is the end of every episode, we have the complete
the
lyric
section.
Yeah. Oh. So I believe it was your lyric last time, wasn't it?
It was indeed, yeah. So my lyric was, I'll play it deadpan just to see if you can get it, but I'm sure you can. My lyric was, me, honey, and me make boololoop soon.
Very nice. Just in case there are any new uninitiated listeners, this is where we don't have to find out what the song is. We have to find the very next line that comes in the song, which is trickier than one might think. So let's hear that line one more time.
Okay. This was, me, honey, and me make boololoop soon.
So obviously it's underneath the mango tree. I'm going to have to go through underneath the mango tree, my honey and me. My honey and I boololoop soon. Mango, banana, and tangerine. Sugar.
Do you know what? You got it right, but almost the wrong way around.
Oh, bollocks.
So the words... Everything you said the answer within that.
But I just got the fruits the wrong way around. Is that what I did? Yeah. Did I jumble on my fruits? Yeah. Mango, banana, and tangerine. Is that wrong?
So go back. Yeah. So go back before that.
Oh. I need the moon in the sky, my honey, and I may boo.
You just said it.
What?
The very first thing you just said.
Underneath the moonlit sky, my honey, and I make boo loops soon.
No. It's. Underneath the moonlit sky follows, me honey and I make moo-loo-loop soon. And then underneath the moonlit sky, me honey and I can sit hand in hand.
Oh, is it? Okay, I fucked up. So I don't have to mention any fruits at all then?
No.
I was on the wrong tangent. I thought I got my bananas and my apples and my moo-loo-loops all mixed up in the wrong way. But very nice. Okay, so just clear it up for me. What is it?
So the line is, me honey and me make boololoop soon. Underneath the moonlit sky, me honey and I can sit hand in hand. There we go.
Beautiful stuff. Well, I sort of got that right and wrong at the same time.
No, I think you got it right. I'm going to definitely give you that one.
Very nice. Do you know what? I think there's you know, old Warren and Cue the Music, you know, he's got like a touring sort of proper professional tribute band Bond act. I think there is room for a Bond karaoke kind of traveling show, don't you? Where you just set up and you get people to get up and sing Bond songs. I want to hear you do Underneath the Mango Tree from start to finish. That's what I want to see happen. I think that would be rather wonderful.
That would be amazing, yeah.
There we go. Good stuff. Coolio, so I have a new lyric for you this week, Chris. Are you excited about it?
Ooh, I am. I like the lyric section.
Good.
Okay.
My lyric for the week is,
yes,
I've been waiting long for one of us to say.
Mm.
That is, I've been waiting long for one of us to say.
That's definitely, it's definitely getting something that I've been waiting long. Okay, that one I'm a little bit more confident that I'll get it. I've just got to keep playing it in my head.
All right. Very nice. I will reveal the answer to that next time. Now, to round out today's episode, we have what's fast becoming everyone's favourite segment of James Bond Radio, the Bond Celebrity Deathmatch. This is where we draw two top trumps cards at random from the pack and muse on who would win in a fight between those two said characters. Now, round one's already in the bag. We are currently in round two. Who did we have last week, Chris?
So last week we had Emilio Largo versus Teehee, and Emilio Largo was the winner. Even though Teehee had the clawed hand, Emilio Largo, the fact that he out-battled Bond on the Disco Volante was a good thing. So far we have the people that have gone through are Jaws, Oddjob, and Emilio Largo. So it's quite heavy hitting territory already, isn't it?
Like we said, man, the final rounds for this is going to be really tough because obviously everyone here so far has already beaten somebody in round once. They're already going to be a bit handy. Now we're getting some really strong characters facing off against each other. So it's going to be interesting to see. And Largo, he's a tough dude, man. So he's a surprisingly tough one. So should we do this week's draw?
Okay, so rather than flicking it, because there's not a lot there, what I'm going to do is just shuffle them, and then whenever you say stop, whatever's the bottom card, I'm going to put to one side and mm-hmm. do it that way.
Okay,
or whatever's
nice.
The top card, you decide. Should I do top card or bottom card?
Do bottom card.
Bottom card. Okay, so I'm going to shuffle, and then you tell me just as and when you want.
Stop.
Okay, so that is number one, and we'll go again.
Stop.
Okay. Number two. So in the red corner we have dun, 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 one of your close friends, should I say.
Oh,
Xenia on a dog.
Oh, she loves me. I bumped into her into the supermarket, Chris. She was so happy to see me. Oh man. Yeah, she loved it.
She's,
didn't she?
Okay, absolutely.
Yeah.
Battling Xenia we have you're not gonna believe this.
Who have we got?
It's only Alec Trevelyan.
Oh. Oh!
How about interesting now, is that? So,
that is
come
interesting.
On.
Now, this raises a question, actually. Do you think Trevelyan and Xena were having it away with each other?
Well, this is it. I don't know, you see, because he obviously sampled, or at least said he was going to sample Isabella Scorupco.
Tastes like strawberries.
Yeah, you know. But yeah, no, it's a bit different, isn't it, with Xenia. I don't know. And it's also, how loyal do you think she is? Because she obviously works for him.
Mm.
She's part of that whole Janus group. But how loyal would she be in a battle sort of thing? I don't know.
So let's weigh them up one by one.
Okay,
then.
Let's go with Xenia first.
She's good with the thighs. She's very good with the thighs.
Great thighs.
Absolutely.
Crushing.
She's one of those that enjoys pain and inflicting pain on others. She sort of has a little orgasmic squeal when she's mowing down everyone in Sevenaya.
And again when she's crushing the animal and stuff.
She likes biting lips. And she's very physically capable. She's very handy. She's good at driving fast.
Yeah, she headbutts Natalia, didn't she?
Yes, she certainly does. Yes, and she has the added thing of being extremely beautiful at the same time, so she can lure people in with her looks. So she's got a lot in her favour at this point. Yeah. How do you feel? Have you got any other thoughts about Xenia?
What else? What else does she bring to the table? I mean, that's a lot. She's obviously good with weapons like guns. She's very handy with a gun, various types of guns. She's not frightened by abseiling down off a helicopter.
She is missing.
I don't think she's afraid of heights or anything like that. She's got a cigar, so she might do a Largo and use that for heat.
That's true.
She is partial to a martini. Straight up with a twist.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that. She's part, you know, into her gambling. And she likes driving fast cars. Yeah, it's quite a tough cookie, I think. So
she certainly is. So let's have a look at Trevelyan now.
Right, okay.
Trevelyan's strength. He's a 00 agent, Chris. I don't know whether you're aware of that. He was actually
006.
He
was 006?
He was 006, Chris. So he's going to gone through all the same rigorous training that James Bond has gone through. So he's going to be a tough mother. As the fight on the, you know, on the big dish at the end of GoldenEye proves, that was a brutal fight between the two of them. Very evenly matched as well, it must be said.
Yeah, definitely.
He's pretty young and fit. He's in the prime of his life, so it's not like he's older or anything like that. He's in great shape. He's obviously, you know, an evil genius. So he's the head of the Janus tree, and all that kind of stuff. So. He's right up there as well. This is a tough one to call.
Yeah.
Potential weaknesses. So what would you say is one of 006's weaknesses?
Maybe the whole woman side of things, but I don't know if Xenia would come under that or whether he's so professional that he wouldn't go there because, you know, of their working relationship. I don't know.
He's got somewhat of an ego, because do you remember when Bond says to him, you're nothing more than the common thief? He didn't like that, did he? He doesn't like to think of himself as a common thief. He likes to think he's a sort of higher level than that. So maybe his ego could give way. See, what I'm thinking is maybe Xenia could lure him in with her sexuality and get him in between her thighs, and then it's game over for Trevelyan.
Yeah.
But whether Trevelyan's obviously going to know that's one of her modus operandi's. So is he gonna be aware of that and be like, I'm not getting near those thighs. It's from behind or nothing, Xenia. I'm not getting between them. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. The fact that they'll know each other inside out in terms of their sort of strengths and weaknesses. It's a tricky one because they're both tough cookies. They both know, you know, against anyone else who they didn't know, you'd say, well, they had, you know, they're definitely be right up there.
Yeah.
But against each other, it's tricky. I think, I don't know, initially, like, Xenia's got so much stuff going for it, but the fact that Alec Trevelyan is 006, he is a 00, he knows what Bond knows, he's done all of that sort of stuff.
Well, do you know what? You could say that, but let's face it, Chris, the other 00s tend not to fare that well in terms of the dying stakes, do they? That's all true. Tend to end up dead. So that is a factor to take into consideration, because let's face it, none of the other 00s are equal to 007. You know, they can try, but they're not there. Yeah. I would say of the 00s that we see on screen, 006 is definitely the closest in terms of, you know, what he can do. Ah, man, I'm finding this one a tricky one. For me, I'm mulling it over in my mind, and I'm usually by this point, I have a gut feeling of one over the other. Yeah. In this one, I don't. I don't know. How are you feeling? Yeah.
I, to be honest, one hasn't come forward either, and I thought it might. Like,
shall we pass this one out to the listeners?
I think we're going to have to, because don't forget, she's an army pilot as well. Yeah. She can fly helicopters, do all that sort of stuff. This is tough, but I think we're going to have to put this out to the JBO audience. Because, well,
there it is. We've hit a stalemate. It's Alec Trevelyan versus Xenia on the top, and we just can't decide. So, what do you think, JBR listeners? Let us know on Facebook. We'll post a little poll. Cast your vote on the Facebook page. Let us know what you think. Interesting.
I, in all honesty, if it came out as one or the other, I'd be happy either way. In my mind, like Trevelyan, you could say the whole 006 thing, but Xenia, you know, she's got the whole killing with her thighs plus all the weaponry and stuff like that. So
yeah,
interesting.
So there we have it. Sending it out to the JBR family. Let us know what you think. So that just about rounds out today's episode, doesn't it, Chris?
It does indeed. Yeah, I think it's been an interesting one. Obviously, the interviews were, like, you know, so much fun, and I do love the interview podcasts. They're great, and
me too. That's like one of the best things about doing this podcast, I think, is being A, to interview people we'd never have the chance to interview otherwise, but B, actually having it in a situation where you can sit down and actually have a proper chat about Bond and all that kind of stuff. It's bloody lovely. Now, obviously, if you want to meet Caroline and Martin yourselves, well, you can, because they're going to be appearing at the Mid-Atlantic Nostalgia Convention very, very soon on September the 17th, 18th and 19th. That's at the Hunt Valley Wyndham at Hunt Valley, Maryland. So that's obviously in the States. There's a big old Nostalgia Convention. They're both going to be there. You can go and meet them, hang out, get autographs, all that kind of stuff. So make sure you do that. If you want
when
to,
is that again?
That's the 17th to the 19th of September. And if you want to find out more, the website is midatlanticnostalgiaconvention.com. That's midatlanticnostalgiaconvention.com. So make sure you go and check that out. In addition to our two esteemed Bond girls, there's a ton of cool celebrities that are going to be there. You've got Lee Majors, absolute Hollywood legend, the Fall Guy, $6 Million Man. You've got Lindsay Wagner, the original Bionic Woman. You've got loads of them there. So you've even got Dean Stockwell, who was the dude in Quantum Leap, not the actual dude that jumped, his mate that used to show up and help him out, the hologram guy, whatever his name was. I haven't seen that show in years. He's going to be there. So make sure you go, grab yourself some tickets, and go and meet yourself, Caroline and Martine, and a bunch of other celebrities too. It's going to be good fun.
Nice. Very good.
So, Chris, I suppose we should mention today was originally going to be an MI6 mailbag episode where we answered the listeners' questions. But obviously, we had more important things to do because we had two esteemed Bond girls show up instead for an interview. So we put the mailbag back. So mailbag's happening next week now. So obviously, if you have any questions for us and failing any, you know, superstars that get in touch and want to have a chat on James Bond Radio, that'll be next Friday. But, you know, if Sean or Roger gives us a call before then, we might put it back another week. But we'll see. So James Bond Radio will return next week with a brand new MI6 mailbag episode. Until then, I've been Tom Sears.
I've been Chris Wright.
And we'll see you then. Take it easy.
Have a good one, everyone. Bye.
Bye.